Coming up this week, off screen.
A tale as old as time gets retold in Beauty and the Beast.
Jordan Peele wants us to get out.
The story of one man's battle with ALS is told in Gleason.
There's a trip to Spain to recover an olive tree.
Katie Cassidy has wolves at the door.
Asghar Farhadi sends the salesman over.
And Christian Stewart gets to something ghostly as a personal shopper.
All those to come and more, off screen.
This is off screen. Latest film news and reviews. This is Offscreen, the on-screen radio show.
Welcome to Offscreen. I'm Van Connor.
I am Kase Allen.
So, Mr. Allen, before the news, before the reviews, before the box office top 10 this week, start us off with, I think you have some remake / reboot news for us?
I do, to the power of two.
Okay.
I have two pieces of remakes /
films never get remade or rebooted.
No,
such
never.
A rarity.
I know. I mean, we're not going to be talking about a reboot today on the show at all, are we? I wonder what's going to be coming out.
I think we've got... No, we've just got a remake this week, I think. We've got... it's just a remake.
Just a remake, not a reboot.
Not a reboot.
Because there is an extremely subtle difference between the two. Okay, the first one, it has been announced it was going to be a remake of The Fly.
Which I love. I love The Fly. I love the remake of The Fly.
Yes, as we were just talking about off air. Yeah. So the David Cronenberg one is not actually the original Fly, but it is much beloved in the way that John Carpenter's The Thing is beloved. Mm-hmm. Yeah.
Hopefully that won't get an awful sequel prequel then that weirdly uses the exact same title. But
I didn't hate it. It has to be said, I didn't hate it, but I think that's just like, you put Mary Elizabeth Winstead in anything, and chances are I'm probably going to enjoy it.
Don't ever watch A Good Day to Die Hard. That's all I'm going to say.
Oh.
She does count.
Like, I know.
Did we see that together?
No, I was in Cardiff. Yippee-ki-yay, Mother Russia. Anyway, back to The Fly.
So The Fly is being remade.
Yes, by the guy that did a film called Slight, which I've not seen, but I heard good things
about.
Shady
Dillard. Yeah, it was a big thing at Sundance, wasn't it?
And it seems to be a thing now, where like... up-and-coming horror directors are being given these kind of, like, beloved franchises or beloved classics and given, like, a fresh spin. So the guy who did Mama from a few years ago, he has got It. That's coming out this year, I believe, now.
# justice for Nacho Vigilando. Anyway. seriously, did you ever see Open Windows? I really liked that one. Mm. But
it's all right. But, yeah, so that is the first one. I'll see it. But I'll definitely just... I've got a special place in my heart for the Jeff Goldblum version.
Does this mean we'll get a remake of The Fly 2 as well? Because Eric Stoltz, he's waiting for that cameo call. That's what that
is. Yeah, we know what happens. He casts Eric Stoltz up and then he just gets replaced by Michael J. Fox.
That's it.
That is how it works.
I think it should be like the casting in Bewitched in the 60s, where just halfway through they just switch the actor out. And
but just don't say anything.
Did you know,
the Fresh Prince ante.
In 2005, when they were making the Will Ferrell and Nicole Kidman Bewitched movie, at one point they were genuinely going to swap out the actor playing him midway through.
That'd be amazing.
And just not acknowledge it.
Yeah.
It's just going to be done and not acknowledged. And they never did it, and it would have been the cleverest gag in the whole film.
Even if it's just having them like in really heavy makeup.
That's very true.
Yeah.
But actually, you know, you swap out Will Ferrell with Vince Vaughn, see if anyone notices. But
everyone will notice, because they'll all stop laughing.
That's very true. Oh, no, Will Ferrell with John C. Reilly. That's what you do.
Yeah, that's a good point.
That's a good one.
Okay, moving on to my second piece of remake news real quickly. It was leaked today that Warner Brothers are eyeing to do a reboot of The Matrix.
Why?
I know. They are taking the blue pill.
Taking the blue pill.
That's why. Michael B. Jordan is being eyed to be in that one. And there's been rumblings that it's going to be about young Morpheus.
Okay, I like the casting of Michael B. Jordan. I mean, I'm great with that. That's cool.
I would see him do the dishes. I would see him do absolutely anything.
Fair, fair. Yeah. Although not a Fantastic Four sequel, presumably. You'd avoid that, I guess.
Well, he's at MCU now. So he's back. He's on
good
inside.
Hands. He's
yeah.
good hands now.
Exactly. But so in terms of who's going to be involved, looks like Warner's trying to get back with the Wachowskis, but not to direct. We just want them to kind of like give their blessing. But they're not going to talk to Joe Silver about it.
Yeah, fair enough. So they don't want old Joe. Do you know what it is? Too many Steven Seagal movies he's peddled him over the years. That's
far
what that
too
is.
Many, yeah. There's only so many times you can pitch an executive decision sequel.
There's only so many times you can get the Indian frills and Aikido combo just right.
Yeah.
You know?
Isn't he like a sheriff now?
I think he is, yeah. He's a county sheriff.
A county sheriff, yeah.
He is a county sheriff. He also has his own energy drink line, his own aftershave, and his own clothing line. all of which have ridiculously overwrought names that involve the use of the term cigar.
Basically. He's got to have like his own brand of cigars.
Yeah, he also has a burger chain called Fat Cigars.
Oh, I love that more than the Wahlburgers thing in America.
Never ever ask what Alan Cumming's range of products is called.
No.
Just never ask.
Maybe we'll talk about it on Podcast Extras.
Podcast Extras,
that's one of our
maybe.
Favorite things.
Yeah, we can't discuss it otherwise, but yeah.
So moving on to people that like to dip their toes into various waters and try different things. Jordan Peele has made a film. He's directed a film for the first time called Get Out, which I heard you enjoyed.
I more than a little enjoyed, yes.
I liked it somewhat.
I liked it somewhat. This is the feature debut. Jordan Peele, with this film, has become the first black director ever to make $100 million on the first go.
How amazing is that?
That's astonishing. Now, of course, you and I are big fans of Jordan Peele from his TV work.
Key and Peele.
And then, of course, they've spun into movies now because that show's ended. They've gone into movies. They've done Keanu together. They've then gone their separate ways. Key is in The Predator. Peele is doing Get Out, and apparently he has four more of these to wheel out over the next 10 years.
He does, and also when their show came to an end, he said that they are going to be doing more films together. They're going to be doing more projects, but just one sort of like a Richard Pryor, Gene Wilder kind of a relationship.
And you can't begrudge them. And you know what? If the results are going to be half as good as this, you have my blessing, boys. So this is the story of this old story: boy meets girl, boy falls in love with girl. Girl takes boy home to meet her parents. Something horrible, horrible, horrible happens, and it's a mortifyingly overblown, socially relevant horror film. It stars Daniel Kaluuya, Bradley Whitford, Catherine Keener, Stephen Root, Alison Williams, and you know what? Here's a clip.
So how long has this been going on, this thing? How long?
4 months.
4 months?
Mm.
5 months.
Attaboy, better get used to saying that.
Please, I'm so sorry.
Oh, yeah, I'm sorry. She's right, I'm wrong. See?
Does he have an off button? No. This is exhausting.
I know, and I want to give you a tour.
Can you, unpack first?
You want to unpack? Before the tour?
Your favourite Mr. Whitford there, and because we're both West Wing fans, so we love a bit of old Bradders.
It's Josh Lyman.
Exactly.
Dana.
Exactly. What's the Gilbert and Sullivan song they have a whole episode about singing? He was an Englishman?
Yeah.
Anyway, so back to Get Out, which is as funny as you'd hope for from Jordan Peele, far, far scarier than you'd think. And it's scary in that way that horror movies should be, in that it relies on different forms of horror. It relies on a slow, sustained scare. It relies on a jump scare. And it doesn't lean too heavily into one. It just throws them all in and says, I can't just do one, I can do them all, and I can space them out efficiently, and it works. Now, with all these horror films, especially one where there's a sort of mystery element to it, there is obviously a big reveal. And the hammer in this case, I say I have to be really careful about spoilers with this one. Do not let anyone spoil this film for you, and if they do, slap them hard across the face. Tell them we sent you. Anyway, the hammer falls about an hour into this, and it is about an hour and 50 long. The hammer falls about an hour in, and unlike a lot of horror films, which, you know, I'm trying to think of a good example, Disturbing Behaviour, remember that?
Yes.
In the way that Disturbing Behaviour, once the hammer came down, they made the big reveal, it kind of all fell apart. This is one of those movies that gives you its big twist and then says, right, now we're just going to run with that. And because it commits to it, because it has absolutely no shame or anything about it, it delves into the ridiculousness of its own concept. It's got really, really, I mean, predictably clever things to say about race. There are some gags in here that will have you absolutely howling. And there's a recurring gag, for instance, that every white person he meets says, I would have voted for Obama a third time if I could. And it's really clever and really topical, and it works. And the performances are terrific. Daniel Kaluuya? Kaluuya? I think.
Yes.
Is it Kaluuya?
Kaluuya.
Because I keep saying Kaluuya like the drink.
Like the drink. No, yeah. It's Kaluuya.
Yeah. John Coffey like the drink, but spelt different. Daniel Kaluuya like the drink, but spelt different. Okay. Although technically speaking.
That's his new name.
That's his new name. Although technically speaking, we are feeding into the themes of Get Out by doing that. But he's terrific in this. I mean, genuinely terrific. To the extent that you think of the whole Samuel L. Jackson thing from last week, when he made the comment about British actors taking American roles.
He's gone on Twitter now to kind of, like...
Dial it down.
Dial that down. He was like, that's not what I meant, and I'm sorry if that kind of got mistreated.
Don't even know how he got to that stage, because Kaluuya is brilliant. Kaluuya is brilliant. Mm. Alison Williams will surprise you as well.
She's my favourite girl of the girls.
She's my favourite girl of the girls too, actually, as well. Yeah, because she's the only one I can tolerate. her and Adam Driver, the only two characters on that show I can stand.
I like Andrew Annals. Andrew Annals is good. You will know who is.
Is he Elijah?
I think he's Elijah.
So... I loved it. I love the cast. The writing is sharp. The writing is concise. The scares are fast and furious. The comedy will have you absolutely howling. You will come away from this film and think, wow, just yes. Mm. That 99% Rotten Tomatoes rating that was so advertised when it opened in the US deserved.
Is it still at 99?
It was for about a week. I don't think it still is. But it was absolutely superb. You are going to love it. You are going to get absolutely nuts when you see it, Kase. I'm presuming you're going to pop at some point this Sunday or something into it.
I'm seeing it Tuesday. I'm seeing it on my birthday.
Oh, excellent.
Yeah, because nothing says 28th birthday like casual racism.
You know what? Fair play to you, because I think it'll be the perfect birthday film for you. It's got so much of the things you love. Mm. It's going to do you well, I think.
And, you know, Jordan Peele and Bradley Whitford.
I know.
Bradley Whitford in a film that is successful.
I know.
I need that in my life.
But also, we need to plug the podcast before we move on.
We do. Just before we do, get out. Still at 99.
Still at 99. Yeah. Excellent.
So, you know, bully for them.
Bully for them, sir. Well done, Jordan. Well done. Right. Now, Key, where's your movie, pal? Come on. Go on. Direct something. Direct something.
I'm sure he will.
He will. Yeah. Totally will. Okay, so podcast edition. This week, we've got The Salesman, The Olive Tree, and Gleason that we can't fit into the broadcast version of the show. So download the podcast edition on iTunes, on Acast, Deezer, TuneIn. Just type in Offscreen. It's on there. And after the credits, you get a whole extra section. And and also, you know, it's an award-nominated section as well. So, because
we need to get an award noise whenever we
do.
Like some trumpets.
Next week, we need a gong. That's what it is.
Need a gong.
In fact, why don't we just use one right now? Here is our awards gong. And there you go. And, right, so we've been nominated for the British Podcast Awards in the TV, Books and Film category. We've also been nominated for the Listener's Choice Award, which Kermode is up for as well, so we stand absolutely no chance of winning. But
I don't think that's fair, because he's got... I mean, he's all over the schedule, isn't he? And he's got too many mediums, he's got books, he's on TV
as well. Let's hope, then, that he's spread himself too thin and see if we can draw up some votes.
Like the hair gel that he uses to put that quiff into place.
I'm pretty sure it's brill cream. I'm telling you now. Oh, it might be that DAC stuff. Remember that?
Ask him. And then we will tell all.
I'm going to ask him on Monday. I'm going to ask him. All right, but we need your vote in the meanwhile. So please, if you even vaguely like this show, if you can tolerate even just Kase, if you can't stand me, that's fine. If you just like Kase, just go on to britishpodcastawards.com/vote and vote for Offscreen. Notably, not the one with a hyphen in it, because there is another show. Don't know what it is. But
don't just type in Kase either.
Type in Kase. We tried to vote for Kase to win a podcast award, but it wouldn't let us. In which case, we'll come back after this.
With the latest film news and reviews, this is Offscreen, the on-screen radio show.
And we're back, and you know where we've got to go now, Mr. Allen. We've got to go to California in 1969, the summer of love.
Yeah, that was a happy time, wasn't it?
It was.
Any cults, weren't any murderous families, none of that jazz.
They don't hardly got no murders or nothing. Because I had to do a reference for an estate agent for a mutual friend of ours the other day. And I jokingly told him that I had declared he ain't hardly done no murders and nothing. Which of course
it's true. I can vouch for that as well.
We can. Which of course is a line taken from the first Ted movie. So Wolves at the Door, which comes to us from John R. Leonetti and his frequent writing partner.
Great name.
Yeah, and his frequent writing partner, Gary Debhauser, I think his name is.
Okay.
They have brought us such cinematic gems as The Butterfly Effect 2.
I can sense the tone.
And Mortal Kombat Annihilation. And Annabelle. So
really?
Yeah. Because that's what I call failing upwards.
That really is.
Mortal Kombat 2, Butterfly Effect 2, Conjuring spin-off.
I don't know if it was the same dude, but did.
Same dude.
That made a lot of money.
It did make a lot of money, but I think the groundwork was kind of done for him there. To be, I think anyone could have directed Annabelle. But he has now directed this 73 minutes long film, which stars Elizabeth Henstridge, from most known for Marvel's Agents of S.H.I.E.L.D. She's Simmons. And Casey Cassidy, most known for being Ruby on Supernatural, the good first one. And Black Canary from all the DC shows.
Laurel.
Yeah,
the one that keeps dying and then...
coming back.
She's not dead.
Yeah. She's died a thousand ways. She's still around. Right, so this is the night of the infamous Manson family slayings, the murders of Sharon Tate and all of her friends, her three friends. And basically, it takes place from the perspective of the victims, and it's just played as a straight slasher movie. It is notoriously difficult to find a poster for this film. It is notoriously difficult to find a logo for this film. A clip for this film is next to impossible. I wonder what that could possibly be. Here's a clip.
What was that?
Okay, so I love Bradley Whitford so much, I'm going to try to link him to most of the films that we're going to be talking about today.
Really?
So this film has Jane, how do you pronounce her name? Kazmarek,
I think.
Kazmarek, yeah.
Malcolm's mum.
From Malcolm in the Middle.
Malcolm's mum, yeah.
They were married in real life.
Bradley
Whitford
way.
And Jane, yeah.
Okay, so you're going to find a tenuous connection from Bradley Whitford to every movie on our docket this week.
That's the plan. Will I do it? Stay tuned.
Do you know what? I'm looking forward to seeing you try, sir. Mm. And I'll tell you what, what we've just done for like 8 seconds, so much more interesting than Wolves at the Door, which is awful. It doesn't have a beginning, middle, or end. In fact, the whole film feels like the second act of a bigger film about the Manson family.
That's not good.
Yeah. They don't. There's no sort of acknowledgement of the Manson family until the very end when you get the sort of newsreel bit. It is sloppy, lazy, scripted as if it's trying to troll its audience. I mean, of course it's grisly, but it kind of needs to be. Noticeably, there is not even a single mention of Roman Polanski anywhere near this thing. And although that's kind of, you know, removing him from history unfairly, you can't help but feel they kind of did him an unintentional service here. This is awful. It is boring. It is plodding. It drags like you wouldn't believe. 73 minutes. 73 minutes. And I can't help but feel that might be because there was about 17 interesting minutes to packed in there throughout. And John Leonetti was challenged, you know, defied to try and remove them and make the worst possible product. It's almost as if he accidentally did a good job with Annabelle and he got home and his wife said to him, you know what, John, I think you've done us all a disservice here. You've accidentally made something good. And given your track record, maybe you should try and undo that. And he said, I'll tell you what, I'll make it crap again on the next one. And he has. He absolutely has. This is
man of his word.
Beyond terrible. I hate it. I actually hate it. It makes me feel ill thinking about it. Please give me something nice in the news to take me away from this awfulness.
Okay.
Go on.
Dan DeVito is going to be in Dumbo.
He's not actually going to be Dumbo, is he?
Oh, what a twist. I would love that. I feel like that would be an idea they would have on It's Always Sunny.
Yeah, that would work. That really would.
Yeah, where they try to do like a music... Like you see how successful the live-action Disney adaptations have been, so they try to make their own, and they cast Frank as Dumbo.
Oh my God, that would be an amazing episode. That really does, doesn't it?
Rob, call me.
Who is he going to be?
They've said that... in fact, I don't know if they have said. They've said that Eva Green is going to be a circus leader's assistant. But
I'm sure he's the ringleader of the circus, isn't he?
I don't know if he's going to be the ringleader.
I think he's the ringleader, and then the bad guy ringleader buys the circus.
There's a competing...
There's a competing circus leader who buys his circus.
Right,
so
okay.
Tom Hanks will buy Danny DeVito's circus.
Really want Tom Hanks to do it. I mean, I wanted Will Smith to do it, but you know, I mean, the love of being in Suicide Squad 2 is obviously...
I mean,
way more appealing.
How do you turn that down, man?
How do you turn that down when you've got Jada just being like, Will, we got bills to pay.
This mortgage don't pay itself, Rash.
Jada needs to get his hair rebraided. He's only got it done 2 days ago.
Should we move on to the box office top 10 for this week?
I think we better had.
Number 10.
50 Shades Crapper.
It really is as well. It is just the worst. It really is. It's one of those... Because there was a whole thing this week about The Handmaiden. We're getting the sort of preamble for The Handmaiden coming out now. Yeah. And I think Peter Bradshaw wrote a piece in The Guardian this week about the return of erotic cinema. And he specifically brought up that 50 Shades is kind of too watered down for the demographic that used to really enjoy erotic cinema. Basically, the kind of films Adrian Lynn used to produce in like the late 80s, and basically the entire reason that Mickey Rourke ever had a career. Remember that? Remember what Mickey Rourke?
I do. Had, do was you remember a, when Mickey Rourke was going to win an Oscar, and then Sean Penn was like, "Nope."
Yep, I do. Yuck. I do recall. Yeah, but no, 50 Shades is just—it's the worst kind of lowest common denominator, made for Cinemax, but lacking the gumption to commit to its nudity requirements. It is just the worst piece of hogwash you'll find in a multiplex this year. Aside, of course, from anyone unfortunate enough to see Wolves at the Door.
Number 9,
La Traviata. It's a Metropolitan Opera, and I'm really happy that I pronounced it correctly.
I'm impressed that you did.
I am a cultured
student. I kind of feel like it was all for nothing, though, because neither of us have seen it. So, idle-dee-dee, as Jay-Z said, on to the next one.
Number 8.
Lion Cub.
Lion
Turn
Cub.
Turn into Lion Man.
Now, see, that's an It's Always Sunny moment. Yeah. Lion Cub turns into Lion Man. No, I like Lion. You liked Lion as well. I'm amazed this is... And this is a non-mover again. This has been at number 8 for how many weeks now? It's been out for 8 weeks, but it's been at number 8 for a long, long time. It's got to be at least a month. That's
something like that, yeah.
But, no, go and see this. Please see Lion. It's great. See it while you can. Obviously, it's riding some awards high still, and fair play to it. Deserves it.
Number 7.
Hidden Figures.
I couldn't possibly comment on Hidden Figures. I mean, it's not like anyone's talked about Hidden Figures at all or given any publicity. I mean...
No, it's a film for our times, set not in our time.
Exactly. I mean, it is... It's very
it's
much...
Good. It's enjoyable.
It is that fluffy, lighthearted help.
It's really good. I got an answer correct on Pointless the other day because of this film. There was there was a question, and one of the answers was the astronaut that goes to space we have to save. His name is John Glenn, and I got it, and I got like 5 points, which is a pretty good answer for Pointless.
Isn't John Glenn played by Glenn Campbell from Glenn Campbell or Glenn Powell?
Glenn Powell.
Glenn Powell.
Glenn Campbell. Very different guy.
Very different. Yeah, from Everybody Wants Some. Our favourite character in Everybody Wants Some.
Oh, he's
some.
Incredible in that. And Screen Queens as well.
And Screen Queens, yeah. Oh, man, I love that guy.
Chad Radwell.
Yeah, I know. Chad Radwell.
Just Marvel need to snap him up.
Please, yes, please snap him up and...
Make him someone in the Captain Marvel film. That'd be amazing. Make him like a pilot or something.
Oh, no, Captain Marvel is DC. Because the name's like a trick. It's weird.
No, but they're still...
Oh, no, hang on. No, no, no.
Yeah, so Captain Marvel. Brie Larson. They're still calling it Captain Marvel.
They're still calling it Captain Marvel. Okay,
as far
enough.
As I'm aware.
That's fair. That's fair. Yeah. Okay.
No trouble, man. No trouble.
No trouble. No, it's because Shazam... Yes. Shazam is actually Captain Marvel, isn't it? Something like that.
Yeah, it's all...
It's a whole weird thing, and it's never made any sense. But I don't care. Marvel, you're right, should absolutely hire Glenn Powell, who isn't Glenn Campbell.
How much is Disney paying you to say that, man?
Number 6.
Sing.
Which was still no Ed Sheeran. I'm sorry, Kase. When it gets to like week 9, I might chuck you one in, but I'm not going to torment you till then. Well, what's left to say on it? Kids will like it. Adults will tolerate it nicely. Mm. Toe-tappingly sing along to it. And there's some celebrity voices
there. There's some stuff.
There's some colourful stuff, and it's from the Minions guys. And if you're inclined to watch it, odds are you're going to like it.
Latest film news and reviews. This is Off Screen.
And we're back. So, Mr. Allen, should we spend some time with our personal shopper?
We should, but before we do, let's just talk to our pal Brad Whitford again. Try to link him to personal shopper in some way.
Okay.
So, yeah, we were talking about this off air.
Okay.
So the way that we managed to link the two together.
The
so
complex web we weave.
This is insane. Today, this is, yeah. This is quite a Herculean task.
You realise we've basically invented the game 6 degrees of Bradley Whitford.
Yes, so... It's our own bacon.
Who needs Kevin Bacon?
Right, so you go, Bradley Whitford was in Cabin of the Woods.
Yep.
as was Chris Hemsworth.
Yes,
Chris Hemsworth was in Snow White and the Huntsman.
As the Huntsman.
And Snow White was...
Kristen Stewart.
Who is in...
Star of Personal Shopper. Boom!
Credit to you, sir. You got that one.
Okay, well, we do this often, you know. It's just
we've already loaded up the next film as well. We know what that pathway is going to be. It's going to be a lot easier.
We have like three to the next one. That was the annoying part. Right, so Personal Shopper, which has been getting some buzz for about a year now, hasn't it? This is by Olivier Assayas.
Yeah, didn't she win a French Best Actress award?
I believe she did. But this is her reunion with Assayas, who did Clouds of Sils Maria?
Or maybe it was that one she won. She won something.
Well, it could be either one, to be honest, because they both had the same kind of... Is it Sils Maria, isn't it? Clouds of Sils Maria was 2 years ago. She's now reteamed.
Juliette Binoche.
It was, yes. But the thing is, Clouds of Sils Maria was the one that made Kristen Stewart sort of taken serious. It got her taken seriously a little bit. This is very much one of those as well. So she plays a 20-something American living in Paris. An American in Paris. Imagine that. And the idea is her brother has recently passed away from a heart condition that she shares. Her twin brother, incidentally. And she is also, as well as being a personal shopper, she's a medium. Because that's
right.
As you do, she's also a medium. She is sticking around Paris 3 months later, even though she has no reason to be. She's actually waiting around to see if his spirit will contact her there. And into this mix as well comes a mysterious, malevolent presence, which seems to be taunting her both physically in person and by iPhone. This is actually a spirit with iMessage, genuinely. And
this is not what I thought this film was about.
I know. It is a ghost thriller with Kristen Stewart and iMessage. So here's a clip.
What are you doing in Paris?
I'm waiting. I'm gonna go.
What are you waiting for?
My brother died here. My twin brother died in Paris.
An accident?
No. No, heart attack. I actually have the same malformation.
Does it scare you?
No. I didn't scare him.
Ms. Stewart there. And, okay, here is the first of two things I'm going to say this week that are going to absolutely flabbergast you, Mr. Allen.
I'm not easily flabbergasted. I feel like I'm quite unflappable.
Prepare to be gasted, if not flabbered. But Ms. Stewart is brilliant in this.
She's been brilliant before.
She's actually brilliant. I dislike Kristen Stewart. I've never particularly found her an enjoyable presence. And yet... she's so perfect for this film. Mm. Don't get me wrong, this is not a mainstream hit. You know what this harkens back to? Things like Don't Look Now. You know, European set, but American-made horror films of the 70s and 80s. American-made, sorry, not American-made at all. But, you know, things like Don't Look Now.
We've got, like, some American cast members. Like,
yeah. But it used to be people
if
like
I
Jane
take
Fonda.
It back, isn't Donald Sutherland Canadian?
He's Canadian, yes. So,
from that side of the pond,
but
we say.
From over there. But this is very much a sort of updated take on those kind of films. And it really, really works. I mean, it's gorgeously shot. There's some fantastic visuals in there. But it's a very cool, very icy sort of an atmosphere. And because obviously there is an element as well with the actual presence of ghosts. They've created a really interesting take on ghosts, which is to have an image which is sort of out of focus, an image that's disintegrating, as it were. And it's really something to behold. They don't over rely on it, but the writing's quite sharp. The ultimate conclusion of it is somewhat open to interpretation, and you come away and just think, wow, that worked mostly, I think, because of Kristen Stewart. Like, I feel if it weren't her in the lead, it wouldn't ever have quite as gelled. No, but it does work, and it's quite evident that Olivier Assayas does know how to write for and shoot Kristen Stewart. I mean, and her role here is she's basically fearless. It's a really fearless performance. It's really something, and you get to see her absolutely run the gambit. There's depths I didn't think she could quite reach that she does almost effortlessly. I thought it was great. And you know me and Kristen Stewart, I never thought I would say that.
Yeah, you've got a bit of a rocky past, haven't you?
Yeah, rocky past with her movies. I mean, I think after Panic Room, it all went downhill.
What next? You're going to pay a compliment to Lena Dunham?
Imagine such a bonkers idea. Why don't you give me some news before we finish the top 10?
I'll give you some news. In fact, yeah, this is interesting. Let's do a like a pre-countdown.
I thought you were going to say it was something to do with Lena Dunham. We've got Lena Dunham.
Let's talk about Lena. Yeah, she's actually here today. She walks in. The UK, apparently, I wasn't aware of this, but we voted as a nation for our favourite film soundtrack.
Did we?
Apparently so, according to London's Royal Albert Hall.
Okay, fair enough.
That venue did a survey. So I have the top 10. I know right now you're not going to agree with this.
Fair enough. Go on, knock them down for me.
I will knock them down. So starting at 10, Jurassic Park.
Okay, great soundtrack. We're talking about score, aren't we?
Yeah, okay, this is the interesting part. This is why I take umbrage with this list.
Not soundtrack, because soundtrack is Watchmen. Score is E.T.
Yeah, exactly. Right, yeah. So Jurassic Park, 9, Gladiator.
Fair, I'll go with that.
8, Back to the Future.
Cool, yeah.
7, Magnificent 7.
Okay, also, that works.
Also love that is at 7.
Well. I love it. Big fan of that. It's a good one, isn't it?
Number 6, Great Escape.
Okay, yeah. It's fairly iconic, isn't it?
Very iconic.
These do seem to be mostly singular iconic themes, don't they?
Yeah.
These seem to be iconic theme songs.
And here is the rub with this.
Okay.
Carrying on, Lord of the Rings trilogy. I feel like I can't really argue that, but I wouldn't put it at 5.
Okay.
Number 4, Harry Potter and the Philosopher's Stone. Just the first one, instead of just saying... Right. Yeah, I know.
But the third one has the best score.
Mm. Wait for the top three.
Okay.
Number 3, Star Wars.
But
it just says
Star
Wars.
Wars?
It just says Star Wars.
I think that actually does mean A New Hope. When you say Star Wars, I think it used to. When I was a kid, Star Wars meant A New Hope.
Mm.
And, yeah, okay.
Yeah. Number 2, Chariots of Fire.
Again, iconic theme.
Iconic themes.
Yeah.
And this is where the first one will come into. What do you think number 1 is?
Indiana Jones.
No, not in the list.
Really?
Yeah.
Okay, what's number 1 then?
Titanic.
What? So hang on, so we've got iconic themes for 10 till 2, and then number 1 is the one you know the pop song from. In which case, why the hell isn't Robin Hood Prince of Thieves on that list?
Why isn't the song from Three Musketeers in that list if we're talking about Bryan Adams songs? That's got Sting and Rod Stewart.
It's All for Love, baby. Yeah, an awful one. All for One, All for Love.
Anyway, should we go to number 1 and continue the box office top 10?
Ooh, what a segue. You are getting pro. Mm.
Number 5.
Moonlight.
Well, I loved it. You loved it. It's gorgeously shot, well acted, superbly put together. It held not only my interest, but my emotional investment. And yeah, I really loved the hell out of this. I mean, it deserved a Best Picture.
Yeah, I'm so happy that it's just back in the top 10 and it's got legs.
I mean, it's a non-mover this week, isn't it? It's a non-mover.
Yeah.
Yeah, good.
It's just a lot of people just going to it and saying, oh, look, Rami's got an Oscar.
Do you know what? Fair play to him. I mean, Trevante Rhodes is currently filming The Predator.
The Predator, yeah.
With, of course, our boy, Mr. Key. So,
I love that cast.
It's such a good cast. Oh, who joined it this week? Jake Busey.
No.
Jake Busey has joined The Predator.
Really?
Yeah, that's actually a thing.
How did I not know that?
We'll talk about it more later, but Jake Busey's joined it. Oh. So, but no, Moonlight, you got to check it out.
I want to go back and watch The Frighteners now.
I know. Starship Troopers for me, I watched it last week. But why do I need a knife and a nuke fight anyway? Anyway, so Moonlight's amazing. You must check it out.
Number 4.
Viceroy's House.
Which is this sort of reductive populist take on the partition of India. This is the weird thing. People have been saying, oh, it's a populist sort of sensibility, as if that's a positive thing. Let's not forget, we currently have a US president who's a populist idea.
Who didn't win the popular vote.
Didn't win the popular vote, but still. But this idea that populism is a good thing right now is not particularly right. Mm. This plays just like, Downton does Best Exotic Marigold. And the problem is, it can't make up its mind as to what kind of tone it wants. If it wants to be a period piece drama, if it wants to be a great sweeping historical romance, if it wants to be a down and dirty political period thriller, I would, I'd go for any of them. I don't have a preference as to which one of those I'd like to see, but just picking one rather than this hodgepodge that it actually turns out to be would be an improvement.
Number 3. Darkness.
No parents. Lego Batman film.
Lego Batman film. Just, you've obviously seen this and loved it, and so did I, and loved it.
It's doing well, isn't it? It's been here for 5 weeks now.
5 weeks, and it's gone down one spot.
And it's still made quite a chunk of change.
It
as well,
really
so
has.
It's nothing to be sniffed at. It is not successful.
I think so. I think its current box office worth is 240 million, isn't it?
Yeah, something like that. Which worldwide. Is pretty good, and it seems like they kept the cost quite low.
They have kept the cost quite low. It's still 200 less than the Lego movie, though, strangely. Because you would have assumed that Lego Batman would have actually made more than the Lego movie. But, and it kind of deserves to in a strange way, because even though it is more specific, and actually, weirdly, the worst parts about the film are the parts where it becomes a Lego movie spin-off when the whole Master Builder thing comes up. But other than that, it is a genuinely brilliant animated spin-off. Will Arnett's perfect in it. In fact, the whole cast, perfect. I don't have a weak link in this cast.
Do you know what I heard? I heard that Will Arnett is Ben Affleck's favourite Batman.
Really?
Which makes me happy.
You know what? I always said that Ben Affleck had taste in everything except signing on to be Batman.
Number two.
Logan.
Which I loved. Did you love?
I loved. You know I loved.
Oh, yeah.
Everyone loved.
The thing with Logan, I mean, it's a movie that... It's blindingly gristling violence.
Yeah, it has no right to be as good as it is.
But that violence only works as well as it does because the scenes in between, the dialogue-driven character scenes, are so brilliant. I walked past a man in Waterloo the other day, by the way, a very stuffy middle-aged fellow, turning around to his friend and saying, "We went to the cinema and I saw this film and it was called Logan and it was about a little girl and a man with knives in his hands. It was excellent." And you know what? That I'm just going to let that...
Yeah, it sums it up, doesn't it?
That reviews the film perfectly, doesn't it? That was his exact voice as well.
Number one.
Big Trouble with a Monkey.
Big Trouble in Little Skull Island.
Yep.
But,
Kong.
I really liked Kong Skull Island. It's one of those films that I don't know if you've seen this. There's a lot of pieces being written about revisiting Peter Jackson's version now.
Yeah, and do you know what? I watched the first half. It's a long film.
Did you lose half a day? Because
it's bloody long.
It's a long film.
I remember really enjoying that when I saw it at the cinema 12 years ago. Is it 12 years?
2005. Yeah,
2005. Yes, roughly about 12 years ago. Yeah, I like that, and I've not seen this yet, and I will. But I'm going to see other things first.
It must be killing you inside. There is a movie starring John Goodman and Brie Larson.
And, other people I like as well.
Who else do you like in this? I mean, Samuel L. Jackson, obviously.
Pretty much. This is a pretty great cast. There's no one I dislike. And there's people who I love seeing in big projects like this, who I love, like John Ortiz. And, yeah.
I mean, I personally think...
Corey Hawkins.
I was going to say it could do without Corey Hawkins, but...
That's a shame, because he's...
He's just not interesting in it. And that is unique to him. That's not the film. Don't get me wrong, the film has an issue with its character writing, which is that it's basically non-existent. But Corey Hawkins, currently on TV, is faring just as well on 24, where he can't hold your interest there.
It's a shame,
either.
Because he's so great in Straight Outta Compton.
I know! That's what's really annoying, isn't it? But the thing is, Kong's the star. John C. Reilly otherwise kind of owns the show. Well, in fact, it's the Johns. The Johns own this. So, C. Reilly and Goodman. So,
good man. Did you see Jeff Bridges presenting him his Walk of Fame star?
I did.
It was incredible. He said, "He is a good actor. He is a good man. He is John Goodman."
You know what? I think that nothing sums up John Goodman better than that, I don't think.
With the latest film news and reviews, this is Offscreen, the on-screen radio show.
And we're back and dancing. So, Mr. Allen, we're going to have to review Beauty and the Beast, but this presents you with a unique challenge because, of course, we need a Bradley Whitford link.
I don't know if this actually is a challenge. It seems like the easiest one. In fact, I feel like I could have a difficult one and an easy one.
You could do multiple ones with this. That's
in fact, I will. I will make up one and I will have the actual one. Okay. So, Bradley Whitford was in Save Mr. Banks with Emma Thompson. Emma Thompson is in Beauty and the Beast.
She is Mrs. Potts. This is exactly...
And then a way more tenuous one. Bradley Whitford's character in The West Wing, his first name is Josh.
Yeah.
Josh Gad plays LeFou in this.
Really? Yeah. That is about as tenuous as you can. He was also in France in the 18th century. And
used to be a candlestick.
Of course, And Bradley Whitford once used a candlestick to light a room.
Yeah, his auntie's first name was Gaston.
There we are. Well, okay, so Beauty and the Beast. You've not been under a rock for 26 years, so I presume you know the plot of Beauty and the Beast. In fact, I know your wife, so I know very well that you know the plot of Beauty and the Beast.
I have seen Beauty and the Beast...
96 times.
Yeah, at least once a year for every year of my life.
I've got it worse. My sister, when she was 5 years old, played the VHS every single day.
Oh, I went through that phase as well, but when I was like six.
Well, as revenge, I thought, in case the movie was terrible, I would take my sister to the Sunday morning family premiere. And she went along and she partook in all the activities, you know, the boomerang videos where you fling roses in the air and have your face painted, things like that. And she came out and loved the film. She absolutely loved it. So obviously it works for fans. This is obviously the story of the prince, who is spoilt, rich prince, with a bit of a vanity streak, who turns away an enchantress posing as a poor old elderly woman in need. In revenge, in response, is turned into an unsightly, grotesque beast. And for some reason, so are all the inhabitants of his castle, his household staff, because that's totally fair. Yeah. Now, here's where it gets interesting, because this version includes a new add-on to that. The enchantress also wipes the memories of everyone who has ever encountered them, thus explaining once and for all how no one noticed there was a giant Hepping castle on their doorstep.
That makes sense.
It does, doesn't it? By the way, this also includes family members of the household staff. So, again, plot hole from the animated one, kind of plugged up. Right, Belle's father, obviously, in this version, he's an artist. He's going to market, happens upon the Beast Castle, is taken prisoner for stealing a rose without thinking. And, of course, Belle, his, you know, ostracized bookworm daughter, played by Emma Watson here, trades herself for her father. She's kept by the Beast, and she finds herself usurper, would it be, of this curse, because the whole thing that could undo the curse is true love, and the idea is this girl could be the one. And you know the story, and
I feel like your French accent is about as good as
No, hang on, I did that for a very specific reason. That is Ewan McGregor's accent in this film. She could be the one. Right, I'm going to give you a clip, and I've picked this one very specifically. I will explain why after.
Since the morning that we came to this poor provincial town.
Good morning, Belle.
Good morning, Monsieur Jean. Have you lost something again?
Well, I believe I have. The problem is, I can't remember what. Oh, well, I'm sure it'll come to me.
Where are you off to?
To return this book to Père Robert. It's about two lovers in fair Verona.
Sounds boring.
Look, there she goes, that's going strange, no question.
Dazed and distracted, can't you tell?
Go on, why does that annoy you, Mr. Elm?
Because that clip confirms what I had thought, actually, that it gets rid of possibly one of my favourite lines from Beating the Beast.
Which one?
Marie, the baguettes, hurry up. And, like, it's supposed to be there, and it's not there.
It is done it's done as a visual gag. It is there.
Right.
Right, the film is a beat-for-beat remake. You know how we talk about Kenneth Branagh's Cinderella and how it actually fleshed out that story? Because there wasn't really much story to begin with. There was the basic fairy tale element, but the characters didn't have personalities, for instance, or, you know, subplots or arcs or anything like that. They had to be invented for that film. With this film, all the groundwork's been done for them. So, really, there's not an awful lot to do, but address some plot holes, give certain characters a backstory that they were otherwise really in need of, case in point, Gaston and LeFou, and that's it, really. Other than that, it's beat for beat. There is nothing added to this film narratively that you haven't already encountered. There is this strange character arc afforded Belle, which has to do with her mother, which establishes quite why she's so odd.
Yeah, because obviously that is not in
the, not in the original. But they also do the same kind of thing, almost flippantly, for the Beast himself. He has parent issues as well, because whatever happened to his parents is never brought up in the 1991 Disney one. If you love the Disney animated 1991 movie, you're going to go nuts for this. The musical numbers that you have cherished your whole life, they're all there, and they've got new sparkly arrangements, and they've got some new ones that I think are from the stage musical. Because I think a few from the stage musical have been thrown in as well.
I think they have written at least one brand new one. Alan Menken has come back.
After Belle goes back to save her dad, there is a musical number the Beast has that I'd never heard before. And it's him alone singing. And I'd never heard this. I presume that is from the stage version.
It's probably from the stage version, yeah.
But the cast, mostly great. Mostly great. And I say mostly, considering... I don't dislike Ewan McGregor at all, but the accent is just, really, you couldn't have found anybody better than this, because it's such, it is the
cliche. Yeah, I always thought it was strange casting.
It is. I mean, you can see why they've visually done it, but you just, it doesn't get, they just get a voice at all, he really doesn't. And bearing in mind, of course, he has to sing Be Our Guest. So you get this walloped in your face for about 5 solid minutes with the put on your napkin round your neck, shitty, and we'll provide the rest.
At least he can sing, though.
Not in that accent.
Is it because he was in Moulin Rouge? Do you think we were just like, Moulin Rouge set in France? He sings really well.
It seems to be that logic.
And also, his wife is French.
Is she?
Yeah.
Okay. It seems to be that kind of logic, though. I mean, I will point out that there are other cast members
who
fare a lot better musically.
I didn't have issue with Ian McKellen, but I know some people had issue with Ian McKellen being Cogsworth.
I like him very much.
I think they had that because he didn't look physically like Cogsworth, but obviously it's on mocap.
Right. So getting to the motion capture and everything. Right. Here's where it gets really wrong. And this is the worst thing I can say about this. This is the only bad thing I can say about the film, actually. Right. They've put such visible effort into making all of the household staff in their anthropomorphic sidekick states look so believable. You wouldn't think it. They do. They work. So Cogsworth, Lumiere, Mrs. Potts, it all works, and it all looks like these are actual physical objects with faces on. And you think, okay, that's impressive. That they've done such a good job then feels almost disappointing when you get to the Beast. And that just doesn't work. The effects aren't there. Dan Stevens' performance is great. He makes for a really great Beast. Mm. And he's brought enough emotional investment to it that you actually genuinely don't consider the animated version at all at any point. The only problem is he is let down by ropey facial effects. The body is okay. It's not brilliant. The clothes look weirdly plastic and manufactured.
Yeah, but the face.
The face doesn't. And you can't figure out, like, the Ron Perlman version looked better than this. Remember the Ron Perlman, Linda Hamilton one?
It's difficult to forget once you've seen it.
Yeah, works better than this version does.
But that's all the facial prosthetics. And
having
stuff,
actual and facial fuzz on there would have worked a lot better.
Ron Perlman gets up in a day. Like, he's uncomfortable unless he has to spend 4 hours in a makeup chair.
I think his wife wakes up 6 hours before him and starts applying things when he wakes up.
That's how he looks like Ron Perlman.
He doesn't know each morning what he's going to wake up looking like.
Yeah, his face actually starts like a foot beneath the makeup.
Exactly. Yeah. But Emma Thompson is great, obviously, naturally, but Emma Watson... here's my second one of the week. Emma Watson is terrific. This is the best performance I have ever seen from Emma Watson. I need a shower, so excuse me. But no, genuinely, I thought it was great. I really like the writing for Gaston and LeFou. Incidentally, if you're trying to find is this better than the animated movie version, think of it in this way. Who sings Hurt better, Johnny Cash or Trent Reznor? Same exact question for this.
Trent Reznor.
You think Trent Reznor, really?
Trent Reznor.
Okay, this is the Trent Reznor version of Beauty and the Beast, but to be fair, if the original was Johnny Cash, this is the Trent Reznor version.
I like the Johnny Cash one a lot. I think it's really great, but yeah, Trent Reznor.
But yeah. You're going to love it. Cast are great. Gaston works better now that they've added a whole soldier backstory for him. LeFou as his sort of lieutenant / hanger-on works a lot better. Josh Gad plays it brilliantly. And by the way, if you're one of those people who's offended by the gay controversy thing, believe me, Disney in animated form have done a lot worse than this.
Josh Gad may be the most perfect casting.
He's brilliant. He's so good at this. But the weird thing is...
Something who else you would get.
All that controversy, it does amount to like a Star Trek Beyond thing. Where he's like, what was anyone concerned about here?
Just one throwaway thing.
Not the birdcage. But anyway, loved it. Absolutely loved it. It's a genuinely terrific film, musically, visually, stylistically, performance-wise. I thought it was great. And here's my big dilemma. Is that film of the week, or is it Get Out?
Have them both.
I'm going to say,
Have a tie.
I'm going to say, well, Get Out only works for the 15 and above audience.
Oh, so as a family film.
So for everyone, there's Beauty and the Beast.
Yeah. And then when you want it to be a little bit blue.
Yeah, when you want a bit of blue for Dad.
Bit of blue.
Bit of blue.
When you Get Out.
Yeah, Get Out. Then Get Out, yeah. Get Out and see Get Out. And then when you're coming down from that the next day and you want to just feel comforted, go and see Beauty and the Beast.
See, I'm doing it the wrong way around, aren't I? Beauty and the Beast first.
Is that how it works for you? You do the comfort first and then the fright.
Yeah. That's all that. I like to be lulled into a sense of security.
Is your wife going with you to see Beauty and the Beast, by the way?
Yeah.
I was going to say,
Of course.
she's restraining herself long enough to
I actually don't know who's more excited, me or her.
Because I thought she... I remember we bought her the Cogsworth pop figure.
Yes, which is quite a place on one of our shelves.
But So, next week, interesting stuff. We've got The Eyes of My Mother, which is the... that's a horror film, I believe it's set in Portugal? Portuguese horror film, I think. Lost City of Z.
Oh, is that next week?
That's next week. Charlie Hunnam and Robert Pattinson, I believe, isn't it?
Robert Pattinson, great beard in that film.
Yeah. Mm. Who also, of course, starred with Kristen Stewart in Twilight, who, of course, then starred with...
link Bradley Whitford directly to Robert Pattinson.
Right. Chips is next week.
It's Chips next week.
Chips is next week.
Nice. I feel like I've been asleep for like a month.
Yeah, you got Chips is next week, so a bit of Mickey Pena for you there. Aquarius. What's Aquarius? That's next week.
But, I don't know.
We've also got Another Mother's Son. We've got The Autopsy of Jane Doe. That looks intriguing. And you can't have missed the advertising for this one, Life, the Ryan Reynolds, Jake Gyllenhaal sci-fi movie with your lady, Ms. Rebecca Ferguson, in there as well. So
that should be good. Yeah,
could be interesting.
It's the guys that wrote Deadpool.
It is. So this is kind of Ryan Reynolds' reward for being right about Deadpool all along.
Have a big sci-fi.
Yeah, you did well. Now have a big sci-fi film. So yeah, all those to come more next week off screen. In the meanwhile, this has been a Kenny Stubbs production for On Screen. I've been Van Connor.
I've been Gaston,
and we're back next week.
Just show me the way to get out of here, and I'll be on my way.
You've been listening to Off Screen. For more news and reviews, visit onscreenfilm.com.
Okay, cut. That's a wrap.
Extra podcasty bits, then, Van.
Indeed. So, give me some news then, Mr. Elm, what you got for me?
Can
I just specify, the reason I did use that Beauty and the Beast clip, by the way, was because, that, as you know, that takes place very, very early in the story. The bonjour, that song. That's like the introduction of...
Your French accent. bonjour.
I'm going with the standard of accent in the film.
That was just like generic Euro trash.
Oh, yeah, totally. That's my Euro trip. That's it. I'm going with the Euro trip version of casting. But that's a point at which I realised within about 10 seconds of that song, I thought, you know what, we're going to be okay. We're gonna be fine.
We're in safe hands.
So there you go. Explanation given. Please news me, sir.
We have a domino. I wish I'd mentioned this in the main show.
Okay,
it's kind of big.
This
news,
is domino in Deadpool 2, isn't it?
In Deadpool 2,
right, okay.
Yeah. So the actress, somewhat of an unknown, which I really like.
I can't
like
the actress. Name.
She's called Zazie Beetz.
Zazie Beetz,
which sounds less of a name, but more of like. Of an offshoot of Beats by
companies?
Dre.
Yeah,
a little bit, yeah. Zazie Beats by Dre. But she's
like
she's
the
really
Beach
cool.
Edition, doesn't it?
Mm. I know her a little bit from Atlanta, because I've not finished Atlanta.
Oh, of course.
Yeah.
Is she John Glover's girlfriend?
Yes.
Oh, that's
with,
her.
With really ace hair.
Yeah,
very cool. She is also in Easy, which has been Netflix show we both really liked.
Ah, who was she in Easy? Was she...
I've forgotten her name. She's shown in two episodes.
Was she?
Because obviously all separate stories.
The nanny. Was she the...
Yes.
She's the nanny, isn't she? Yes. I did watch Love. Easy, sorry. Easy. Love is the one
I'm watching
song.
Love now. I'm watching season two. Have you finished?
I've finished season one. I've never watched season two yet.
I've only seen the first episode of season two.
I would have watched it this weekend, but there's a certain other show coming out, so... And I don't care about negative reviews.
Oh, I know.
I will watch it anyway.
I'm going to watch it because I'm a completist.
I mean, if I get to the Defenders, I'm not missing their thoughts.
I am viewing this the same way that I viewed when Pixar was bringing out Inside Out and The Good Dinosaur. In that we had a year where we had two Pixar films.
One of these is going to suck.
Exactly. Yeah. Like, if I've got to like endure one that's not as good, I'm going to have somebody better. And this year we've got Defenders and Punisher.
Yes,
so as long
true.
As one of those delivers, I'm fine.
I'm sure I read somewhere they cast Microchip for the Punisher one, and it was someone I really liked.
Huh.
But I'm sure you'll find that out. I'm sure they did cast Microchip, and there's a new trailer apparently coming shortly for The Punisher.
Well, it'll be after Iron Fist, won't it?
Yeah, they'll be usually like the opening weekend, isn't it?
Yeah, or sometimes we'll play it on the actual show. It'll be like the last episode.
We're only 6 weeks away from the next Marvel movie. So,
can you believe it?
I know. We're 6 weeks away. Weeks away of the first of three Marvel movies. So,
Ebon Moss Barak. Name.
I'm sure if I look at, I see a picture of him now.
Moss. This must be enthralling. podcast.
Oh, yeah, we do, yeah.
I recognise that guy. Everyone Google Ebon Moss.
I can't see his face from here, is
it? I know.
Yes, I know him. Yeah, he
was in One Tree Hill.
Was he in One Tree Hill?
Remember One Tree Hill?
That's not what I know. I remember Sophia Bush. Yeah. But
okay. Anyway, let's talk about Domino, because we kind of sidetracked him.
Zazzy Beats.
See, this is what happens when we're not allowed to talk about just film. We talk about TV as well.
Well, Netflix nowadays kind of overlaps so much with its TV content with film that it's kind of excusable.
It is, and I have the king of segues.
Go on.
Because Netflix have bought Orson Welles as the last film.
Which it's was unfinished.
Never unfinished. It was never completed. It's a film called The Other Side of the World. And The Other Side of the Wind.
Yeah.
And what I really, really love about it is in the film, the plot of the film is about a director who's trying to finish an unfinishable film. Which is just like, this is genius.
It is a bit, isn't it? Do you think this might be that Oscar nomination they've so been reaching for?
Oh, can you imagine?
Not nomination, sorry, the Oscar win.
Oscar win. They are laying it on thick for next year. For next year and the year after, because they've obviously bought the rights to The Irishman.
Yep. That company really wants an Oscar.
The week of the Oscars, well, a couple of days after the Oscars are finished, they premiered like 4 movie trailers, like big name ones, like Okja and Bright.
David Ayer is not exactly going to bag them an Oscar nom, but we shall see.
Well, he bagged Suicide Squad an Oscar win.
He did, didn't he? I stand corrected. The Oscar-winning Suicide Squad, of course. Yes.
It has to be prefaced,
Has to be prefaced with the Oscar-winning Suicide Squad. So Domino,
Do you know much about Domino?
I've read a couple of comics with her in, but I've never read anything that really fleshed her out as a character. I know that she is an assassin who has the ability, to effectively... manipulate the odds in her favour of any given... So it makes her a great, for instance, assassin, a sniper.
Yeah.
Because her superpower is manipulating so that she always hits. And that's kind of good. Although, the thing I noticed about this is in the rumours, in the weeks leading up to Zazie Beetz getting cast... There were so many rumours. And did you notice they were all African-American actresses?
They were. Kerry Washington, Janelle Monáe.
Janelle Monáe was the day before Zazie Beetz.
It was,
and I was like,
if it's Janelle Monáe.
Yeah.
But I'm really happy with Zazie Beetz.
I thought because Janelle Monáe was in Hidden Figures, I thought that's Fox as well. It's entirely possible. I liked the Kerry Washington idea, but I thought, I think she's a bit kind of past that now, Kerry Washington.
Maybe a little bit.
Yeah, Kerry Washington doesn't seem old,
because she obviously doesn't look old at all. She's beautiful.
She's past it. I think in terms of her career now, she wants to be more mainstream thriller producer. That seems to be her goal.
Okay. Do you reckon she's just been hanging out with Shonda too long?
Exactly.
Or maybe she's going to go the Viola Davis route.
Entirely possible. That would work because she is a TV actress
Hang out in TV, do Fences, get an Oscar.
Look, I mean, I say this. I'm a huge fan of Scandal. I loves me some Scandal. And for the record, Melly Grant for the win. But,
The only thing I don't like about Scandal is the fact that her surname isn't Scandal. That was just my key.
Her name is Jane Scandal.
Jane Scandal. I feel like there's not enough shows like that. It's just like named after the surname of the lead character.
I think the thing is, her surname is Pope, and I feel like there would have been a great pun title to do with that.
Yeah, Pope and Glory.
Pope and Glory.
Pope and Glory.
Oh, man. Yeah. Although, how good is Joe Morton in that show as Eli Pope? Love him.
Really good.
Hell, it's a show that even makes Scott Foley tolerable. I mean, that takes some doing.
So, what have we covered? We just covered Netflix talking about Orson Welles' new film. Yeah, that'll be interesting. That film, it was 1985 when Orson Welles died, I believe.
Because Transformers, the animated movie, came out the year after, and he's the voice of Unicron?
Yeah.
I think it's Unicron, which seems to be in the new Transformers movie, by the way. It seems to be in Transformers The Last Night.
Have you said who is voicing Unicron?
I don't know, because I know that Anthony Hopkins is an actual person. He's an actual human character, so he's obviously not him.
He's an actual human character played by an actual human actor wanted to get actual human money.
Yeah. I kind of hope with all these actors that do Transformers, I hope they do get paid to the extent that they never need to work again. Like, I hope the reason TJ Miller did the last one, for instance, is because, printing my own money here.
I don't know. I think that was a lateral move just to kind of get him some more notoriety. And now he is an emoji.
Yeah, he is an emoji, true.
Yeah.
But let's talk about the Salesman real quick then.
Do that. I'm going to try and find my Bradley Whitford link. This is going to be tough.
Okay, it's going to be a tough one. So, this, of course, the big thing with The Salesman is that it won the Best Foreign Film Oscar this year.
It did, yes. A lot of people thought it was going to be Tony Erdmann, which yes. you absolutely loved.
I love Tony Erdmann, yeah.
Yeah, up until about a fortnight before the actual Oscars, it looked like it had it in the
bag. I think we can basically thank Trump for this win, can't we?
Yeah, which the director of this did. Proxy, like through...
Well, this is the thing, because obviously the travel ban came in. Asghar Farhadi, the writer-director of this film, specifically then said, even though he was allowed to travel into the US for the ceremony, he wasn't going to on principle because of what it represented. Didn't he send the first female Muslim astronaut in his place?
Yes, which is amazing.
Let's be honest, as far as middle fingers go, that might be one of the all-time greats.
Like, that is much better than Marlon Brando sending a Native American.
Oh, God, yeah, totally. Absolutely. But speaking of the Oscars, by the way, have you started watching Feud?
Yeah. Oh, no, I've not started yet. No? Okay. I forgot about this. Have you started?
I watched the first episode. It's amazing. Is it great? The casting is so good. And we haven't even gotten to who the hell Kathy Bates is supposed to be playing yet, but she's great in it. And also weirdly looks 25 years younger. Anyway... Off topic. So we know The Salesman largely through the controversy around its Oscar nomination and eventual win. What you've actually got, because he's 2 for 2, isn't he? Didn't he win an Oscar for A Separation?
Which is great.
And now you've got, of course, this, which, spoiler alert, is also great. And I didn't know the plot of this. I didn't realise that the title The Salesman refers to the Arthur Miller play Death of a Salesman, which is performed within the film. So you've got the character and his wife, and they are the central character, who is a teacher. He's also doing, on the side, he's sort of an amateur player, amateur stage player as well. He and his wife are starring in an adaptation of Death of a Salesman. Whilst all this is going on, one night he's out shopping. There is a break-in at their home, and his wife is assaulted. And he sets out on this sort of... as well as trying to reconcile what happened in his head and figure out what he can do as her husband, he also, at the same time, has this need, this burning desire to track down the person responsible for it by any means necessary. Because the attacker, who'd been chased out of the building anyway, left his pickup truck behind and his phone. So... Yeah. Huh. So he uses these to try and find out exactly who it was and bring them to justice. It never, and believe me, when it gets there, you're just going to be blown away. It leads to a scene that you can't believe. When you're watching it unfold, you just can't believe this is happening. It's just, wow, this is just not what I expected this was going to be. This is... Wow. I mean, it is a fantastic stage play in its own right. Like, I feel like you could take this on as a stage play, and it would be absolutely terrific. I mean, it's set and filmed in Iran as well. It stars Shahab Hosseini as Imad, the teacher, as his wife. I believe you have Tarana Ali Dusti, and half Arabic, and I can't pronounce these things.
I'm glad that you... I tried it.
Yeah, but no one can accuse me of being ignorant, because at least it's semi my own culture. So, you know, there's that. I'm self-ignorant. That's what it is. And she is absolutely terrific. I mean, he gets, obviously, the lion's share of the screen time, because it's the story is about his response to and his reaction to. He gets the kind of narrative heavy lifting, but boy, does she get the emotional heavy lifting. And she really delivers. It's a film that... It's a slow burn, but you're never less than perfectly interested. You're constantly engaged in it. And I couldn't look away from it. I thought it was genuinely terrific. When it builds, though, to the big reveal, the big third act scene, and it is basically... The third act in itself is basically one big scene. And it's just something to behold.
Just amazing.
It's really something, and it will take you through the ringer. It involves... I mean, it's got a confrontation that you just can't imagine, and not in a sensationalist way either. It's one of those films that you step back and think, wow, I'm kind of impressed that so many Oscar judges just sat through this to actually vote for it. Or were they just reading the paper? Because this, believe me, considering the favourite was Tony Erdmann, you could not ask for anything more of a polar opposite. You really couldn't.
Sounds like
very, very different films. Yeah. And I don't get that. So go on, give me your Bradley Whitford link. Go on.
Right, so you said that within this, there's There is
Miller.
Arthur Miller's
definitely. I knew you were going to go down this route.
But it was the only route I could go down, and even this is pretty bloody tenuous.
Okay, go
you're,
on.
You're going to hate this because it's the only way to do it.
Go on.
Right, so Death of a Salesman is within this.
Yeah.
Death of a Salesman is by Arthur Miller.
It is indeed.
Arthur Miller recently had a tribute Broadway production put on in his name.
Yes.
Within that production was Bradley Cooper.
Yes.
Bradley Cooper's first name is Bradley, as is Bradley Whitford.
F*** you.
That was so difficult. So hard.
Just f*** you, Kase.
Like, I feel like I need to lay down after doing all that research.
Oh. Oh, man, that is... Wow, you really went for it, huh?
I had to bring it.
Well, you've probably got about 3 minutes to come up with a tenuous link between Bradley Whitford and an olive tree, so you know, make it that way.
I'm sure that he's stood next to an olive tree in his time.
I'm sure. Yeah. Absolutely.
Right,
I can do that one for you.
Oh right, yeah, I will flip it. I'll let you
just
do that
just
one
off the top of my head. This is how you connect Bradley Whitford to the olive tree. Right, Bradley Whitford was in Scent of a Woman with Al Pacino. Yeah. Al Pacino was in The Godfather. And of course, what's the family business in Godfather? They own the Genco Olive Oil Company. There you go.
That was good.
That's not bad for an off the cuff.
I feel like we're going to spend an hour after recording this just doing that.
Just deflating.
Anyway, speaking of deflating, DCEU. Let's talk about that for a minute.
Oh, wow. Oh, what they've done now? Which one?
So, Man of Steel 2 is happening, apparently. That's going to be a thing. So, there was rumours...
I'm looking forward to 2025 as well. You know when they finished all the ones that they've got on the docket and they get around to Man of Steel 2?
We will be long dead before Man of Steel 2 rolls in.
Well, Trump will see to that. Don't worry.
That's it, yeah. Actually, yeah, he's the one that's going to be directing it. Might as well. Like, well, he's got enough. Like,
I can direct films. I can direct all of them.
The best films.
I direct the best films. Well, he does know words, so you know.
He has the best words.
Yeah,
words don't even exist. Like Bigley. Anyway, Matthew Vaughn is being hired to direct Man of Steel 2.
Wow. I mean,
yeah, that is shooting for a name.
Well, he has directed an X-Men movie, so...
He has. So he has former superheroes. He's finishing off with Kingsman Golden Circle right now.
Yeah, isn't that later? That's like November this year, isn't it?
Yeah, it's October, November, yeah. Mm. I'm looking forward to that because it was such a nice surprise.
Oh, it'll be fun. It'll definitely be fun.
Yeah, I don't think I've disliked any of his films. Not his direct films, anyway. Like, I didn't like Kick-Ass 2, but he was only an exec producer. Or maybe just a producer. Maybe.
I think he is just a producer.
He's a producer, right, yeah.
Andrew Wadlaw?
Yes.
Someone Wadlaw
directed
it. Yeah, I couldn't stand Kick-Ass 2. And bear in mind, they lost. And that's after they cut out the garish rape scene. I still thought it was too excessive. Mm. But, I mean, have you read the comic book?
Yes.
Yeah, because the Lindsay Fonseca character in the comic book is quite viciously gang-raped.
Yeah.
But whereas the movie obviously turns it into an erectile dysfunction joke because... McLovin. as far as Matthew Vaughn's work goes, yes, I agree with you. I've not actually disliked any of his films.
I like Stardust. I didn't think I was going to like Stardust.
Is Mean Machine one of his?
That might be his first.
Is
it that and then Layer Cake?
I think he did Mean Machine and then Layer Cake. Because I like Mean Machine in a very strange way. I know I shouldn't. I know
it's the Juggernaut, bitch.
Well, that did actually wind up in his X-Men. No, not in the X-Men movie. He left, wasn't it? He started work on X-Men Last Stand because that's why Vinnie Jones is in it.
Oh, really?
Yeah.
I didn't know that he actually worked on that.
Oh, no. He was the first director for X-Men The Last Stand.
And then
he cast Vinnie Jones in it, and then he left.
Right, so he did not direct Mean Machine. Did he write it? Or probably... Because he's probably a producer.
I'm sure he's a producer on, like, Lock, Stock as well.
Yeah, producer on Lock, Stock, producer on Snatch, producer on Mean Machine, producer on Swept Away.
Oh, well. What can you say to that?
Best friends with Guy Ritchie, weren't he?
Yeah, you know what? Sometimes you've got to protect your friends from themselves, you know what I'm saying?
He's a producer on, like, all the British gangsters. Harry Brown?
You know what TV show starts? Either has started this last week or starts this next week.
What's that?
Snatch.
Yeah, with Rupert Grint.
With Rupert Grint. Starts this coming week.
I would be interested to watch it.
Yeah, I would, because he was on Corden the other night.
He was.
Really good lineup on Corden, where you had
Sir Pat Stew,
Rupert Grint, and Dan Stevens.
Yeah, which is great, because he's his son in Legion.
Patrick Stewart didn't know that.
Did he not?
Patrick Stewart didn't know that until Dan Stevens told him. And Dan Stevens, by the way, has the most brilliantly eclectic taste in shoes. Can't fault that.
The last thing I thought you were going to say.
I was talking the other night to Kelly Needham and John Coulson about The Guest. We were talking about The Guest being a sexy movie. I was like, it's a really sexy film. And Dan Stevens, you know, that guy's got serious screen appeal in there. And we were talking about the scene in which he walks out the bathroom wearing the towel and she's talking to him. And it's, you know, you can feel the sexual tension in that scene. Mm. And I summed it up to Kelly Needham. That's a scene you watch and you're just yelling at her to the extent of saying, if you're not going to him, I will. It's just that
I will take that television screen and make it my own.
Because it's a really hot scene. But
He's a handsome man.
He is a good looking man. Sorry, we were talking about Matthew Vaughn.
We've had some crazy segues.
We really have.
Just tangential. Awful one, aren't we?
We really have. Did you know Edward James Olmos is returning to Blade Runner?
Yes, I saw that today, actually.
Yeah, this is the thing.
Yeah. Who did he play in the first one?
Gaff. He was the other Blade Runner.
Yeah.
The only other one we saw.
With a stash.
With his psychotic stash.
Yeah, it's beautiful. I want him to have that.
Oh, man. There's something about Edward James Olmos that he's always been so odd. But at the same time, I feel like he was Morgan Freeman before Morgan Freeman, and yet younger than Morgan Freeman.
Like a Latino Morgan
Freeman. It's very strange. I mean, because he's obviously turned up in Battlestar Galactica, Dexter, things like that. Yeah. Even Agents of S.H.I.E.L.D.
I saw him as a bad guy in an action film a couple of years ago, wasn't
I? No idea. When was he a bad guy?
Two Guns.
Oh, yes, you are right. You are right. Yep, totally. No, he turned up. He's one of the surviving directors of S.H.I.E.L.D. after Hydra.
Ah.
Yeah, because he challenges Coulson. Anyway, but yeah, he's going to be in Blade Runner 2049.
Cool. Are you excited about Blade Runner 2049?
I am, isn't it? That's October this year, isn't it, Blade Runner?
I think so, yeah.
The thing with Blade Runner is there's so much secrecy around it.
I know.
That you think you could even, really
even
make
that teaser
anything.
Trailer that we've seen doesn't give anything.
Show an awful lot. Although, have you seen that meme? There's a meme that's the publicity shot of Harrison Ford and Ryan Gosling.
When Harrison Ford's wearing that t-shirt.
Yeah. Ryan Gosling's got the coat on. And the caption reads, Mr. Ford, it's time for your wardrobe fitting. Ford, f*** you. And then the staffer's response being, okay then. And
then he goes and crashes a plane somewhere.
And he goes and crashes a plane. Which is absolutely true, because why is one of them wearing a coat and the other one's just there in a t-shirt?
Don't know.
But especially the old man. The old man should be wearing the coat. But
you would think.
You would think.
Yeah. He's a replicant. Maybe this is it. Maybe they're actually confirming.
I don't think he could be a replicant, though. He's aged, hasn't he? Replicants can't age.
Maybe it's a new replicant that have built him to look old.
That may be entirely possible.
He's actually gone now.
Will I?
And the original Deckard is gone.
Oh, okay. Well, then... Yeah.
I don't know. Come on, Denis, give me something.
It's true.
Yeah, I feel like, other than it just being Blade Runner, I feel like that is what's really, really making me want to see that film, is Denis Villeneuve.
Oh, after Arrival.
Everything he's made. and including Arrival.
Well, that's the thing. For years, when they were talking about doing a Blade Runner sequel, I always thought, oh, well, Christopher Nolan's your man. And the thing is,
exactly.
Denis Villeneuve has kind of out-Nolan'd Nolan now,
and now
in a short amount of time.
Exactly. And now it's like, if anyone's going to like remake Memento, I know they are, but if anyone's going to do a decent version, get Denis Villeneuve. Just get him. If you want...
If you would like
a Prestige 2, a 2 Prestige 2 Prestigia, get Denis.
2 Abra 2 Kadabra.
Oh, that's pretty awful. How would you do that to Inception? Inception.
I don't know.
I don't know either.
Don't know. No, that one's going to escape me.
So, yeah, just talking about Beauty and the Beast and Disney having live-action remakes and whatnot. You know, but we are getting Mulan.
I do, yes.
I think Mulan might be the next one, actually.
I think it is. I think Mulan's the next one. And then I think it's either Aladdin or Lion King.
I think the way that it's working now, they've got so many in pre-production, and then we're just going to have like a year where they have like three or something.
I think the next one after Mulan is Aladdin, because this week they are casting unknowns for Aladdin and Jasmine.
And they've announced the production dates, but forgot what they are.
Mm.
But they're pretty soon. So they're really pushing that. Because nobody thought it was going to be Guy Ritchie's next film after King Arthur, Sword of, or whatever it is.
I'm just going to put it out there. I mean, they want, apparently, Middle Eastern-looking actors between 25 and 35 to audition for Aladdin.
Yes.
Now, I have considered it. And, I mean, I put it down to two things. One, my face is too fat for me to risk shaving. If I shave, I lose the illusion of a neck.
I think you may be able to go as one of, like, the palace guards. Do you know the ones with, like, the big...
No, I thought I could audition for the market vendor.
The one that tries to take Jasmine's hand?
Yeah. Yes. I thought market vendor, but then I thought, no, because then I'll make an enemy for life out of Omid Jalili, because that's his role.
That's clearly his role, yeah.
Clearly that role's been earmarked for Omid Jalili.
Do you remember, like, the late 90s or 2000s, where it was like,
yeah.
It was Gladiator and Mummy, and Omid Jalili would just turn
up. Hey, I remember when he turned up in Sex and the City 2.
Oh, my God.
Come on.
He's like a hotel manager.
He's the hotel manager in Abu Dhabi. You know, because all we brown people look alike, you know? That's
what it is. And that film
we
like,
all just look alike.
Exactly. And
we could come from anywhere. So Antonio Banderas plays an Arab so often.
The crux of Sex and City 2 is solved with bags and shopping, isn't it, I believe?
No, it's lingerie, isn't it?
Lingerie, that's the one.
They're wearing the expensive... Oh, is it lingerie or designer clothes? They're just wearing designer clothes under the burkas.
I'll be honest, by the time that Liza Minnelli had showed up that film, and that was quite early in the film, I'd already checked out.
I mean, I'll be honest, the only thing I remember about that film is very much enjoying Alice Eve in it.
But, I forgot she was even in it.
I mean, it's a film that genuinely angered me. That opening with the TV, when he buys the TV and she goes off at him, and you're just like, you utterly spoiled.
Yeah.
Jesus.
I also don't like the film, because doesn't she break up... Doesn't Samantha break up with Smith?
Smith Jarrod?
Yeah.
Yes, I believe she does.
What are you doing? You're never going to get better than Smith.
Oh, I know.
I feel like we're just outing ourselves to be massive fans of... Not even massive, just casual fans.
I'm sure I've told you this, but part of the reason I dislike Sex and the City as much as I do is because years and years ago...
I thought you liked it. I didn't realise you disliked it. No, so you're putting it on a front now.
No, years and years ago, I was seeing a girl, and it was very casual, and... On an episode of Sex and the City, which was on Wednesday nights on Channel 4 at that point, the central plot line was Carrie asking the question, what are we? And during the ad break of that episode, I got a text message saying, what are we? And, we didn't have block contacts back then on phones, you see. You couldn't just block someone out of your phone. And
so when you say, what is it like a defined relationship?
Yeah. So that was when I decided I hated Sex and the City. And my life has been better for it.
Well, there we are. If SPJ has given us anything.
SPJ?
No, what's the...
SJP.
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 Come on, three letters. That's far too many.
Were you thinking RDJ?
Yeah, I was. I was actually in your head for a minute.
You were, where everything is about RDJ.
Everything is RDJ. If you just go inside your head, it's just these posters of him everywhere and...
Oh, hang on. Bradley Whitford connection to Sarah Jessica Parker. He's going to go through Nicolas Cage somehow.
Yeah.
Okay. Right, so the olive tree. Because there's a completely nonsensical subway.
Yeah, what was your olive tree link for Bradley Whitford again?
That he starred in Central Woman with Al Pacino, who of course starred in The Godfather, where they own the olive tree. The family business is Genco Olive Oil.
Do it. I'll do the next one.
There you go. So the the olive tree, which is a Spanish sort of familial dramedy, as it were. It leans more towards just being a really light-hearted drama rather than a dramedy. The general plot you've got is you've got a 20-year-old girl named Alma. She's played by Anna Castillo. She's a farm girl. The grandfather lives with them, and the idea is that he's getting on in years. He's succumbing to just a form of senility. He's now become mute, and the family are debating whether or not to put him in a home. And they're all leaning towards the extended family are all basically in agreement, want to put him in a home. She's the lone voice that doesn't want him committed. And committed, is that the word? Not really, is it? But put in the home. But the idea, she realises the only way to get him to speak again is to track down the one thing he loved more than anything in the world, which was the family olive tree, which his children sold years earlier when his condition started to become this way. And by getting it back, she thinks she'll be able to reach him and spare him the home. However... What she then discovers is the family sold the olive tree to a ruthless and evil corporation with a history of bad environmental policies. So she, her uncle, and her platonic friend-zoned BFF, who of course is quite clearly in love with her, set off on a road trip to recover this olive tree. We don't have a clip, obviously, because it's all in Spanish, but it is really something. And it's something because it's really charming and it's really likable. It doesn't particularly have any ideas above its station, but its station is simply to, I'm going to just, you know, captivate. I'm going to give you a bit of whimsy. I'm going to keep you going. These are all likeable characters. We're going to make sure that you come away loving these people. And you do. And a lot of it is Anna Castillo's character. She's terrific. She's got a real presence. I don't know what to say. You can't really define it. There is just a quality to her that you instantly love. In the meanwhile, you've got Javier Gutierrez as the uncle, whose name I can't even pronounce, and Pep Ambrose as Rafa, the lovelorn BFF, as I say. And the trio make for a really good on-screen company. I do like the visual style of it by... I'm going to give you the name, see if you can pronounce this, because I can't. And... Yeah, I'm gonna say Isiah Bolain.
That sounds good.
But I guarantee you that'll be wrong. But she's done a terrific job here. This is a film that really... it is largely set on farms, you know, sort of... and not glamorized, you know, Kansas-like farms, but realistic, muddy, dirty farms. And... somehow she manages to make this call quite charming. The rustic aesthetic of it really works. But you will laugh and you will sort of be moved by it and you'll go along for this ride. And it does all come together for this just absolutely delightful sort of emotional arc. I mean, the fact that it ultimately builds to a scene of three characters eating sandwiches, and yet somehow that's a result. I can't really think of much more to say other than that. If you can manage that, but that's the thing. You've got an impressive female talent in front of the camera, an impressive female talent behind the camera, and you think, okay, that's intriguing the week that Beauty and the Beast comes out. But
take note, Disney.
Yeah, take note, Disney. Yeah. But we're just kind of blown away by that one.
Cool.
But,
I'm going to give you my link for Gleason now, but I'll do some news in between.
Okay, go on.
So,
because I can tell you worked hard on this.
I really have. Yeah. The link is this.
Go right. For it.
Gleason is the title of the next film that we're going to be reviewing.
Yes.
The last one for this week.
Okay.
Gleason is the surname of Paul Gleason.
Okay.
Who plays the really rubbish police chief in Die Hard.
Okay.
There is another cop in Die Hard.
Yeah.
His mate, Al.
Al Powell.
Played by Reginald Val Johnson.
He is, yes.
Reginald Val Johnson was in a show called Heart of Dixie on the
CW.
He
was, yes.
Also in that show, playing a doctor, was an actor called Tim Matheson. Tim Matheson is Vice President Hoynes on the West Wing.
Oh my God. Can we talk about Jake Busey?
Yes, do it. Talk about him.
Okay, so Jake,
come on, that was impressive.
That was good, yeah.
Thank you.
I feel, though, it's like using Cabin in the Woods, using the West Wing is kind of a cheat because everybody's been in the West Wing.
Yeah, at least J.K. Simmons was in it for an episode. Nick Offerman is in it.
Matthew Perry was in it, wasn't he?
For many episodes, least like 10.
But didn't Bradley Whitford's character Josh date Nancy from Weeds?
They're kind of like an again, off again sort of thing.
Man. Did you know, by the way, that Jordan Peele's significant other is Chelsea Peretti?
Yes, I did. Yeah, and she's pregnant.
I did not know that. Yeah. I did not know that Chelsea Peretti and Jordan Peele were a couple.
Hmm.
It makes you wonder who Keegan-Michael Key's dating, huh?
I'll find out. I think he's married, but I don't know who to.
But she's got to be impressive. She's going to top Chelsea Peretti, man. But, right, so Jake Busey has joined The Predator. As usual with this film, there's complete secrecy, no details.
Yep.
You know, we just about know who's in it and that's it. Oh, it's got a bit more of a suburban setting this time. And a couple of the characters are Marines who serve together and seem to be united while they're on leave. Like, they're all on leave at the same time, so they've come together kind of thing. I know Trevante Rhodes and Boyd Holbrook serve together in the Marines, but when you see the cast...
That's all they've said, really.
Yeah, when you see the cast, though, together, most of them do look like serving Marines, like Tom Jane and Alfie Allen. You think, okay, yeah, I believe you all, you're a squad together. But Jake Busey, this is going to be good. If you've got Jake Busey... And, of course, you know the real thing, the real interesting thing, is that his father was in Predator 2.
Yeah, of course.
Yeah, because Gary Busey took over the Arnold Schwarzenegger role in Predator 2. Well, the role that was meant to be Arnold Schwarzenegger. Then, of course, Schwarzenegger turned it down because he said, this won't make money. And
he was right.
So they had to rewrite the character, and that's where they came up with Agent Keys rather than Major Dutch Schaefer. But by the way, did you know The Nice Guys is on Netflix now?
I did. I would like to rewatch it, actually.
I'm going to rewatch it, I think. Yeah. I might find a break in Iron Fist this weekend and give that a watch.
So you say, take a break, you'll watch one episode, and you'll be like, good God, watch anything else and then go back to it.
Casting news. Have you heard about Escape Plan?
Yes.
This is of course, we're excited about this because, you know, director Stephen C. Miller has taken the reins, and we all know that that can only lead to amazing things because we've all seen Extraction.
Have we all?
Yeah, Extraction. And what was the Nicolas Cage one the other week? Arsenal. / Southern Fury. Southern Fury sounds like a fried chicken restaurant, doesn't it?
It sounds like a knockoff of... Do you know when you go to, like, a supermarket and they have, like, their own version of, like, Jim Beam?
Yeah.
It sounds like a knockoff of Summer Comfort. That's what it sounds like.
Well, of course, he's directing Escape Plan 2, isn't he?
He is, and he has someone new.
He does. Well, 50 Cent's back. Have you heard that?
Oh, I didn't hear that.
50's coming back.
Is Arnie back?
No, they've not announced anything on that. All we know so far is Stallone is back, but we're not sure in what capacity.
And now we have Dave Bautista.
Bautista. I wonder if he's going to be the lead.
That'll make sense.
That'd be interesting. Or if
I feel like he's kind of like big enough a name now.
Well, I feel like Bautista could potentially be the new Arnie role.
Yeah, well,
maybe
makes sense.
Maybe that's it. I'd go with that because you know if it's a similar kind of thing. Yes, he goes into another prison, teams up with Bautista.
Like I feel like with how this film is being made, it's not going to be the lead vehicle that he needs. But I think he'd be really good with like his own big.
The lead is going to be whichever Chinese star they put in it, because obviously the movie's being designed to sell in China.
Yeah, it's shooting in China, isn't it?
It is, yeah. It totally is. But
about China money.
you got to have them China bucks, man. You got to have them China bucks. But no, there's... did you hear the Joe Wright thing? You know, Joe Wright dropped out of the lifeboat.
Did he? Was it like a helicopter or something to go pick him up?
Sorry. You know, the lifeboat... That was a good one. The lifeboat is that new Anne Hathaway movie?
Yes.
Yeah.
I didn't hear that he'd dropped out.
He dropped out, but he's been replaced with the director of Mustang, whose name I can never remember.
No.
But I liked Mustang.
Yeah, but I liked it.
He gave that a good review. I've got a picture of Zazie Beetz here, by the way. But doesn't she look cool?
Her hair is amazing.
It is, isn't it? I love that hair. I'm jealous.
Yeah. Have you started watching Blackish?
I have started watching Blackish, yes. And I am quite the fan of Blackish.
Yeah. Her hair reminded me how Rainbow's hair is in that show, like big fro. Awesome.
I was watching Blackish, and he keeps referring to her exclusively as Bo.
As Bo, yeah.
So I thought her name was Bo, like Bo Derek.
It's short for Rainbow.
Yeah.
Because her parents like hippies.
Yeah.
Are you enjoying the show?
Very much. I've enjoyed it a lot more since the introduction of Dion Cole.
Yes.
Charlie is
incredible.
Is wonderful.
Yeah.
And should just... I think he needs his own series now. But also, I find...
I just love how he talks.
Yeah. Oh, God, yeah.
I
miss him doing stand-up on Conan. I thought he was
great.
Yeah,
he was amazing at that.
But you know what? He's moving on to bigger and better things. Fair play to him. Blackish, very, very good. Really enjoyed it. The episode I watched the other day, which had flashbacks to when the dad was a boy himself, and you have young Lawrence Fishburne opening his bedroom door, saying... taking the door off the frame and saying, this door comes back on the day after you move out.
Yes. Oh, Lawrence Fishburne, Live of Fish, is so good about
it. Oh, he is. He's quite likable. You can tell he's just enjoying himself. Because he's a producer on it as well, isn't he?
Yes, he is, as is Anthony Anderson.
Well, I'm just waiting for the day when Gina Torres makes a cameo. But I'm only about halfway into season one, so I can't...
I won't spoil anything.
No.
Did you hear about Fede Alvarez being confirmed to direct the girl in Spider's Web?
Yes. Did I hear right that they're recasting the girl, as it were?
Yeah, I think they're recasting the cast, not just the girl. I think no Daniel Craig, no Rooney Mara.
Oh, wow. But I know it's being aimed for next year.
No Croatian guy from ER, whose name escapes me.
Goran Vižnik.
Vižnik, yeah. From
Vižnik?
Practical Magic.
Yes.
Yeah.
Also,
yeah.
He's the villain in Timeless.
Have you started to watch it? Is it good, Timeless?
I watched the whole first season. I really liked it. It's goofy as hell.
Yeah, it seems very Legends of Tomorrow.
No, it's more straight-faced than Legends of Tomorrow. A lot more straight-faced. Mm. But Yeah.
But good, though.
You kind of like it. You'll like it. It's only 13 episodes, I think. Yeah.
We've talked a lot about TV.
We have. Can I just point out how awful the Taken series is? Because I started to watch it. It is really bad. It's so bad, I can genuinely claim it's the worst thing Jennifer Beals has done. That's really saying something. But
I feel like we need to start taking bets on just what film will be get turned into a show.
Ooh,
next.
One got announced the other day. Oh, man, what was it? There was a movie that announced a series.
Was it...
And I remember thinking it was a step too far.
Glengarry Glen Ross.
I would watch that show. I would watch the hell out of that show.
I actually think could make a decent show.
Training Days let me down. I must say, I've not been as taken by Training Day as I would have hoped.
I feel like with that show, I think that is a good idea to take that film and put that into a show, and I feel like it needed more than just one season, obviously, because of Bill Paxton, we're not
going to happen.
So it's a shame, I feel.
The problem with Training Day as a series is it's too good-natured.
Mm.
It is absolutely
it needs
too
to be,
good-natured.
Yeah.
But,
you know, Donkey Kong needs to have on that show. That's what we're saying.
No, the weird one I like is 12 Monkeys. I quite liked 12 Monkeys as a series. I thought it was really good.
What were the other ones? Man Over 2 Port, that could turn into a show.
Oh, that was awful.
Yeah, that was bad.
I'm sorry, but if you've got Wilmer Valderrama as a regular on your show, you know it's going to suck. I mean...
Does that extend to that 70s show?
Yeah, because it was a real one-note thing, wasn't it? But also...
Yeah, what was the one that was announced the other day?
He was in From Dusk Till Dawn as well, with Valderrama.
See, I never watched that.
He plays the Cheech Marin character.
Is that still going on in the old Netflix?
As far as I know, it's in its third season. I think it's had a third season. And only the first season follows the plot of the movie, and then it does its own thing afterwards.
Mm.
So the second season follows on from where the movie would have ended, with the George Clooney character having gone on to El Rey and blah, blah, blah. But the one I always remember, as far as movies becoming TV shows and it being amazing goes, Nikita, which is the CW version of La Femme Nikita, which I absolutely adored. Mm. And it had Maggie Q and Lindsay Fonseca. And your boy Shane West, because you got to have
Shane West.
Who doesn't love... what's the line from LXG, from League of Extraordinary Gentlemen? Is it, "Eyes open, boy. Can't look after you all the time."
That's essentially like the Inception Tom Hardy Eames line, when he's like, sometimes you've got to just dream a little bit bigger, darling. Giant gun.
Oh, the movie that made Sean Connery retire. And it's not even that awful. It's bad, but it's not that bad.
I've not seen it since I saw it at the cinema all those years ago. Was it 2002, 2003?
About that. 2002, I'd say, at a guess.
Remember that.
Guess, I'd say.
It's got people liking it, and that guy from ER.
And funny link, Petter Wilson, who is in that movie as Mina Harker, played the first TV incarnation of La Femme Nikita. There you go.
Everything's just... tied up
everything.
Need a little package, isn't it?
Not being sarcastic, I'm just pointing it out. Okay, let me talk about Gleason then.
Yes.
There's not an awful lot to say on this one, I've got to be honest. This
isn't Brendan nor Donal.
No, it is nothing to do with the Irish Gleasons.
I watched the Irish Gleasons. I saw season 2 of Catastrophe yesterday. I just watched it all in a day.
Oh, I'm going to watch the latest episode of 3 later.
I've done that. I'm up to date now.
Oh, really? Okay.
I didn't realise that Donald Gleason shows up in an episode.
In the second episode of season 3, yeah.
Season 3,
The job recruiter, isn't he?
Yes.
Yes.
Yeah. I was just like, it's Donald Gleason.
But I'm a big fan of Catastrophe.
Me too.
What do you call it? So Gleason is the... I'm stuck on the Irish Gleasons. Gleason is the story of the New Orleans Saint defensive backer, Steve Gleason, and his diagnosis when he's diagnosed with the ALS. He was diagnosed, I think it was about 2008, 2009. They were the team that famously had to return to the Superdome after Hurricane Katrina. They returned, I think it was 13 months later. After his retirement, he was diagnosed with ALS. And what this film presents to us is a chronicle by Gleason and his wife effectively speaking to camera, and it's from 2008 onwards, and it's how they deal with his diagnosis. We have a clip.
I have been diagnosed with amyotrophic lateral sclerosis, which is it's a disease in the motor neurons. And this disease is almost always fatal.
My first reaction was kind of frustration or anger at the doctor for saying it. And I just was like, there's no way. Like, he's telling me this, but I don't necessarily believe what he's saying.
Okay, that clip is basically the film.
Okay.
Like, it's kind of all like that. Like, that's the tone, that's the style, all the way through. Now, I really, really don't want to give this a bad review. I really don't, because obviously it's a true-to-life tale, you know, it's documentary, it's obviously real. It's a sad story, you know, there's a lot of heart-wrenching moments in it. And, you know, I feel like it deserves better than this. And the problem is, there's not an awful lot to say. The big problem seems to be that for it to have any kind of real emotional resonance, you have to sort of, you have to know who he is. And outside of, you know, the NFL, that is not going to happen. You know what I mean? Are you having the same ear problem that I have when you've got the headphones off too long?
Yeah. I feel like my ears have been stapled to my head.
You do. But no, the problem is, it's not that he's unlikable. He is quite a likable guy. He has a sort of Chris Pratt-like quality to him.
He's a likable guy.
Yeah, and he's a very likable guy. But you know, like, in that way that you would totally believe Chris Pratt as an NFL player?
Yeah.
Same exact thing here. He and his wife are both very likable people. They seem to have quite a lovely family. And obviously the story is, you know, staggeringly tragic. The problem is that outside of the basic day-to-day of living with ALS, which, I don't get me wrong, that is an important thing, and I feel like that needs to be explored in documentaries. Let's be honest, we live in a world in which most people don't know what the Ice Bucket Challenge was in aid of. So, yeah. You know, obviously, there is room...
It was just putting ice on your head.
Yeah, there is obviously a ways to go as far as, you know, raising awareness for ALS beyond YouTube gimmickry. But the problem is, it just deserves a better film than this, a better film than what's effectively a semi-famous person's diary. And that's what you get here. You've got, you know, a famous person who you don't know doing a video diary. And I feel bad for talking down. I really, really do. And I do wish I could give this a better review. I really do. But it's just not up to much. And it's a shame given the subject matter. You know,
story, but the way that it's been told.
It would be like if you hated Moonlight. If Moonlight was a crap film, you'd hate to give that a bad review, given what it represents.
Yeah.
I mean, luckily it isn't.
It's just as well that it is.
Yeah, it's a good job. Fantastic. It's one of the year's best, but, you know, it's that case, yeah. And kind of hate it for it.
I think that film will be a lot of people's best film.
God, yeah. Moonlight's going to wind up in a lot of top fives at the end of the year, but... Yeah.
It'd be interesting to see how many La La Land will be.
Yes, it will. But, by the way, bit of not really film news, kind of release date news. Did you know that Meg got pushed back?
Yeah, I did, but I'm kind of happy with it, to be honest.
Because now it's a summer blockbuster.
Yeah, so now it's going to get, like, more of... Yeah, it's going to get more traction.
So,
it's ace.
The Jason Statham killer, Mega Shark movie... Do you know the plot for this?
Don't tell me. It's something to do with Rain Wilson's character. He's like some business guy. Or businessman, if you will.
I'm not sure about Rain Wilson.
Tell me, man.
Right. There is a submersible scientific research vessel off the coast of China that has an accident when they uncover the megalodon, the mega shark.
Yeah. How big is it again?
Is it 40 feet? Something like that.
I thought it was like 75.
Oh, 75 foot. Yeah, 75. Yeah, sorry. 75 foot mega shark, prehistoric shark, which they awaken or something. They get trapped underwater, and it's up to Jason Statham, a legendary diver, to go and save them. But bust this. Jason Statham has a past whereby he has accidentally faced this megalodon before and must face his fears.
Oh, that's genius. What is his name going to be? What is Statham's name going to be?
He needs Jonas Taylor. That's actually his name. Jonas Taylor.
I wanted it to be more like on the nose. Like I wanted to have like water in the like Flynn Waterhouse or something.
Something like Jack Rivers.
That's way better.
And his sidekick, his token Chinese sidekick, is going to be played by Li Bingbing.
Oh, but, right, yeah. She's good, I like
it. Hang on, is it Li Bingbing or Fan Bingbing?
Oh, yeah.
I always get the two confused because
one's an X-Men.
Such a specific surname, isn't it? But, oh, man. Okay. But
it's also a noise that Donald Trump made to win the election.
It is true.
He said bing, bing.
And, he did.
That was president.
Yeah, so didn't he get pushed back, I think, from May to August? So
yes,
next
like that,
August, we get the joy that is Meg from the director of National Treasure and Sorcerer's Apprentice.
Yeah, John Turtletop.
Turtletop.
Yeah.
I mean, that is going to rule. Oh, it's also now going to get an IMAX and 3D release.
Because you need a big screen to see 75-foot shot.
China, yeah. Have you seen the first image from it, which is the Megalodon with a surfer going over it?
Yeah.
Oh, man, I can't wait for this movie. You had me at Jason Statham Mega Shark movie,
I mean,
but, you know.
When I first heard about it, I thought that Jared Butler was going to be announced.
Oh, mind
now
you.
Now it's got some credibility.
Was it last week after the show that we watched the Geostorm trailer?
Yeah, and I proposed to you, sir, we watch it again.
Oh, good God, that was a good trailer. Yeah.
I've not seen the trailer yet for Atomic Blonde.
Ah, so, that's quite good.
So, I would like to watch it. It's got good reviews from South by Southwest.
It has, yeah.
It's just been premiered, as did Baby Driver.
That's what I was going to say, yeah.
Have you seen the Baby Driver trailer?
No, I haven't.
Then we should watch it.
We should watch that.
And also, literally just the second, the trailer for Coco.
Ooh, is that out?
The Pixar.
Ah, okay, I mean, I've been intrigued by Coco for a while because there's a lot of concept art for that one.
It looks great. I mean, a lot of people are just like saying, oh, it's like Book of Life and stuff, but it's, I mean, we are allowed to have like more than just one film set about Mexican David.
One trailer we did watch recently, we watched Song for Song, the new Terrence Malick one.
Possibly the most Terrence Malick looking film ever.
It is.
It's all very canted angles.
I was speaking to Robbie Collin from The Telegraph and he's seen it. And he's the review's online now, so you can read it. But he was telling me absolutely hated it.
Mm.
He did also say that it was the most Terrence Malick one yet. So yeah, swings and roundabouts.
None more Malick.
The one I was going to say, to do with the trial. Oh, that was it. No, I was going to talk about because Song for Song reminded me of this because it's Terrence Malick. We didn't talk about Ferrari, did we? The Michael Mann.
Oh, no, yeah, let's finish on that. So it was supposed to be
Christian Bale, who has a history with Terrence Malick, and...
And there's the link. There's your
tenuous link, yeah.
And now link Christian Bale to Bradley Whitford.
I was just saying, what's going to be our Bradley Whitford one? Okay, hang on, we'll try for this one.
All right, I'll talk about you do that.
Bradley Whitford was in... was in Cabin in the Woods with Richard Jenkins, who's
that
in...
That is your link to everything.
Yeah, who's
that's
in Bone Tomahawk with Patrick Wilson,
yeah,
who's in The Conjuring with Vera Farmiga.
Oh, interesting.
Who's in... Hang on, I've got it. Who's in The Departed with Leonardo DiCaprio.
Oh, not the way I would have gone, sir.
Okay, who's in... who's in Body of Lies with... Russell Crowe, who's in 3:10 to Yuma with Christian Bale. Boom.
Okay, nice one. I will take it. I will take part of yours, sir. I will go back to The Conjuring.
Okay.
Which is directed by James Wan. James Wan is going to be directing Aquaman. Aquaman is part of the Justice League. Justice League has Batman. Batman was once played
God
by
damn you.
Christian Bale. I'll win that one.
You case.
But anyway, the Ferrari movie.
The Ferrari movie, which doesn't have a title, still.
I thought it was just being called Ferrari.
I think that's the assumption everyone's always had. But it was going to star Christian Bale. I didn't think they had a female lead at any point. But it's now going to be Noomi Rapace and Hugh Jackman. So, yeah, imagine that. So Hugh Jackman's going to play an Italian.
That's cool. Yeah, he needs to put on some pounds. He needs to, like, basically swap his Wolverine diet.
I mean... You can't get physically further away from Enzo Ferrari than Hugh Jackman.
Have you seen him like do the rounds on the talk shows and stuff recently? Past
some
weeks?
Of them, I've seen
he's,
a couple.
He's
of
been
them.
Telling people like how he's been getting as lean as he has to do to be Logan.
Doesn't he ask The Rock? I thought The Rock gives him fitness advice.
He has been talking to The Rock.
I know that was the case for The Wolverine.
For The Wolverine, yeah.
The Wolverine was
this one in particular. Mm. He was doing like this dehydration technique where for like a couple of days he would drink gallons of water, and then after that we'd have like 2 days where he would just not drink water or drink like hardly anything.
Wow.
And because of that, like, the water underneath his skin would have like evaporated, and so like
there is no
tighter.
Way that works.
That's what he's
no
been saying.
No way. That's awesome.
Yeah, that's it.
I mean, it's psychotic, but it's awesome.
Yeah, he did say many times, don't try this at home. Because obviously he would have like people with him and stuff to make sure that he's okay. But...
When we did the Ant-Man press conference a couple of years ago, and of course the whole big thing with Ant-Man was that Paul Rudd had gotten himself into this amazing
Paul Rudd
shit.
Had abs.
Yeah, he really did. Like... But there was a sort of contest in the room from every, I'm not even going to say female journalist, just amongst every journalist, to try and get Paul Rudd to lift his shirt. I don't know why, it was just sort of silently agreed that this was a thing that needed to be done. And
ladies love Paul Rudd.
The ladies do love Paul Rudd. And Cool James. But the whole thing was, he went on this whole diatribe where he told us how he got into such shape. Mm. And his response was, I didn't have sugar or drink alcohol for a year. Because it was the worst year of my life. And
wouldn't recommend it.
No, wouldn't recommend it at all. But, so I'm always terrified of these extremes they go to.
Yeah, just completely cut things out. Or...
it's like, remember when Chris Pratt turned up at the beginning of a season of Parks and Rec? He's like,
oh, I love that.
You just gave up beer? How much beer were you drinking?
Beginning of season 6, when he's in London.
Yeah.
He goes to London to go work over there for a little bit.
He's been filming Guardians, hasn't he?
Yeah, because he's been filming Guardians. And Peter Safinowicz is in that episode as well. Because he's also in Guardians.
Which one do you think came first, by the way, out of those? I've always wondered, did he get Serafinowicz the gig on Parks and Rec because he'd met him on Guardians? Or did he get him on Guardians because he met him on Parks and Rec?
No, that's what I assumed.
I'm just curious which way around those goes. Because obviously, I'm assuming Chris Pratt got him the gig. But...
oh, I don't know. I don't know if Chris Pratt got him the gig. I thought that maybe, like, Serafinowicz...
just an extraordinary coincidence.
Serafinowicz was cast on Guardians, and then just they were both from they probably just got on really well, and then he was like... shooting something for Parks and Rec.
Yeah, fair enough.
I love Parks and Rec so much. did you know that I've got a spatula, like a meat flipper spatula that says meat flipper that's been burned into it, and it's also got Ron Swanson's face burned into it.
That is amazing. Everything needs Nick Offerman burned into it. But alas, we do not end our show with Mr. Nick Offerman. In which case, here it is.
Your moment of gauge.
Some of the things early on that were described as sort of weird, like eating the cockroach, for example, that was more calculated, from what I understand. Cool. Like you were doing that for effect.
I was trying to get on the map. I started at 15, and I was trying to make a big noise, like punk rock, and say, "Look at me, I'm here," you know, and I want you to remember me. And that was how I did it. You know, I heard stories about Ozzy Osbourne and all that, and I thought, wow, that's wild. But I, when I did Vampire's Kiss, it was my idea.
To eat the cockroach.
Yeah, and the director and I, we were knocking heads a little bit, so he made me do it twice. But I can tell you it was the most disgusting, horrible memory I have of any experience on a movie set. And...
but we're still talking about it today.
But we're still talking about it. And the irony, again, I like that word today, is now you have these things, or had these things like Fear Factor, and everyone's doing it. And it created such a gasp in the audience. And people were shocked by it. And it didn't cost any money. Now, I did get a call from the... I did get a call from the animal rights people on the set. And I said, well, excuse me, do you have a can of, like, a Raid in your house? Do you have a can, you know, are you really going to get mad about that?
They really got upset.
Yeah, there was a few phone calls.